Today we're going to assemble a desktop computer that we call the Tritech Koala. It's mostly off-the-shelf parts, but what makes it unique is that the parts that we put in it are a little bit different than what you usually get when you go out and you buy your typical cheap $300 desktop computer, or even if you buy a $600 desktop computer. Let's begin. We have this case by Enwin, one of my absolute favorites. This computer is in this lovely designer plastic bag. Get it out of the lovely designer plastic bag, because we don't really need that. So here's our case. There's not a lot to be said about it. Big hole in the back. There's two screws holding the top on this particular case. This is one of my favorite cases. We have a DVD drive, an AMD A8-7600, this ASRock A88M ITX / AC. I don't know what the AC means. Is that wireless AC? Maybe, because it contains a Wi-Fi card on the board. And 8 gigabytes of RAM, a solid-state hard drive, and a bracket to adapt the 2.5-inch solid-state hard drive to fit a 3.5-inch bay. This is one of the last things to go in. I'm going to set it on the ground. Step one, open your case. These things can slide pretty well, so don't let it slide off your desk. All right, here's the top. We're going to set him aside. There is this lovely sack of things. I'm going to open it. This is a stand. You use this if you're mounting it vertically to give it more stability. And a bag. So this bag is just so you can have the stand and a completely different bag. Seems a little silly, but okay. What's this bag? Well, this is all the good stuff. This is screws and rubber feet. These are rubber feet. You put them on the indentations on the case. There's some on the bottom I can show you now. Dump this cord out. Do you see those little dots? Those indentations are where the rubber feet go. Your power cord, which you don't really need, you'll give that to whoever you build the computer for. And we have screws. Oh, look, it's a party. This is a motherboard box. This is where everything else is going to go. It's easiest to keep things organized in the motherboard box. We have a manual with a driver disk. We have two Wi-Fi antenna ends here. These will go from the laptop-style wireless card to the backing plate. We have the actual wireless antennas. We have two serial ATA or SATA drive cables. We have the so-called I.O. shield, which is just a fancy way of saying it's the thing that blocks the big ugly hole in the back. And under this cardboard, which I am going to set aside, we have our brand new motherboard. Take it out of the bag, set the bag aside. Keep the foam under it because it's got lots of little pointy solder point things here, and we'll set him aside too. This is where everything is going to go. Everything you're going to hand the person you build the computer for. Power cord, stand. We're gonna use the I.O. shield, SATA cables, antennas, but I don't need the driver disk or the manual because I am a pinball wizard with quite the supple wrist. Before we put this motherboard in the computer, we need to take the power wires loose. There's some rubber bands holding them on in this case. Before we put the motherboard in, we don't have a processor or RAM on this board yet. Let's open this with the pins facing up and be very, very careful. Because if you drop this and bend pins, it is the worst thing ever to get them bent back. Now, we have this beautiful CPU, but what direction does it go in? If you look on your CPU, you will see in this corner, there is a little arrow. That arrow should correspond to an arrow on the motherboard socket in the corner. So match those up. Pull this lever away from the socket and up. It should be pointing up, and you match the corner, and you do not push down. Set the CPU into the socket. It will fall in on its own. Do not push it down. Push the lever and make it click lock there. And the CPU is installed. Take your heatsink assembly. Take this clip and put it here. Get it to hook on this tooth and hold it with your finger so that you can position the heatsink where it belongs without it coming off. It will fall off and it will get annoying. Now this lever is designed to pull up. So if you have this lever in the wrong position, it won't make contact with this tooth. In this case, it's already in the correct position, so I'll put it over the tooth, hold it, and pull the lever over. Match the notch with the one in the slot. It might be a little difficult because this is one of those boards where it's not, it only provides one lever, not two. So you may have to use extra force here. Get it past that, then push straight down with even force until this lever clicks and locks by itself. Our board is ready to go in. We need to install the I/O shield in the back of the case. The metal on this is sharp, so be very careful. To show you how sharp it is, I'll actually open the bag by rubbing it against the metal. Be careful. When you get an I/O shield, you need to look out for these little tabs. There is a tab hanging off the HDMI port, and it will get stuck in the port. Push it up so that it won't get stuck in the port. It needs to be higher than the port so that when you slide the motherboard in, it's not pushing into your HDMI port. Some motherboards have these for all of the different jacks. Some of them have them for only some. This one just has it for HDMI. Now, there's one additional problem we need to address before this goes into the case, and that is these Wi-Fi antenna sockets need to go somewhere. There are knockouts, three knockouts. We only have two antennas. What I like to do, since I know this is VGA, this is where our video will go, and the connector is pretty big, I like to put the two antennas here and here because those are further away from the video card. Usually the Ethernet plug that's going to go here isn't nearly as thick as the video. So we'll just avoid problems down the line, bend the little discs back and forth until they break loose, and throw them away. To install the I/O shield, lift your computer case so that you can see clearly. Put the I/O shield's tab in one side and push it up on another side. It should pop. There are little tiny metal dots sticking up that will grab. And you have it in correctly once every single corner is at the same height. You sometimes will have to push pretty hard from people, and a little bit of a technical glitch there. Some of the video I did just isn't available because it wasn't recording. So, I regret to inform you, dear viewer, that I installed this motherboard with these four screws, and I removed this hard drive cage from this case while the camera wasn't recording. So you're just gonna have to follow along. I have this ByteCC bracket. It's called a bracket-252. It lets you put two 2.5-inch laptop drives in one 3.5-inch hard drive slot. I installed the drive so that these connectors point towards the handle. The drive itself is in the side where the holes are. Now, we're going to take this drive cage, which goes this way, and the handle needs to point towards the open side of this case. So, like that. Get the holes to match up. And for this, we're going to use the hex head coarse thread screws. And because of the way that I do this, it might take a little bit more effort because you're cutting threads into this plastic bracket. The bracket comes with this set of pins. I don't like to use those because then your drive is just held in place by flimsy plastic pins. I'm going to need one more screw than I thought for the other side here. I usually only put one screw in the side that faces the front, just enough to keep it from shaking around. The reality is solid-state drives weigh so little that one screw is often enough to hold them to anything. Assuming you tighten it up okay. So this is going to go here, but before we put this in here, we need to go ahead and get those wires that are going to go here, and we need to bring them over. While we're at it, let's just go ahead and hook some power up. Let's see, the power is here. So we will find the clip. The clip is towards the power supply itself. I'm going to see if you can see that. This is going to go or not go right here and push it till it clicks. It has to click. If you can pull it back off, then it's not installed properly and you need to do it again. And this accessory connector, notice how there are two ends to it. One of them is labeled P2A. The way this works is you slide these connectors together and they become an 8-pin. I don't see the point because it's just the same wires, but what do I know? I didn't engineer it. We're going to plug that in here. These are your power connectors for all of your drives. This is your front panel. And this says panel one is here. So I'm going to go ahead and wire the front panel up. You have to do this based on what the manual says. I just happen to know the standard pin layout. So we're going to at least assume that I have a clue what I'm doing here. Power switch goes beside the protect notch. Power LED. Positive is at the edge, so the blue, which is positive, versus the white, which is negative. The blue goes beside the power switch here, rather, the blue goes up against the edge and it goes beside the power switch in line with it. The reset switch goes beside the power switch in the other direction. The hard drive LED, the red goes on the other corner here. And our front panel's wired up. Now we have this stray one, and I'm just going to bend it back so that it stays out of the way. All right. I already see a problem. This wire runs a risk of coming down and hitting this fan. You can probably see the fan moving when I push down on it. So I'm going to see if the wire will stretch enough. It just might. Yeah, that's a little too much. So we can't push it over here. There's just barely not enough wire. But what we can do is we can route this wire under this clip and push down on it to bend it so that it will have a tendency to stay down instead of up. Let's hook these up, shall we? This is audio. Audio is here. You can tell because there's a missing thing that's away from the edge there. It's not on the corner, it's one over. That indicates audio. And let's push that down. This is a front panel USB header. There are a couple of those there. They're labeled USB on the board. You can actually see it says USB 6.7 here. And that's how we're going to make sure that we don't plug it into the wrong spot. Okay. Here's your drive cage. Here's your connectors. We're going to plug this furthest power connector into the solid state hard drive. Like so. We have these SATA wires that send the data to the drive. These wires, I'm going to straighten the kinks out of them so that I can work with them more easily. One has an angled end on it, and one does not. This is a problem because there's really not any good place for an angled end in this case. But these are the wires we're given, so they're what we have to work with. The solution I have found is to take the angled one, put it on the solid state drive's data connector here. It will click into place, and then preemptively bend it so that when it goes back in the case, it will get pushed up. You can already see part of the problem with the way this is set up. There's very little room to work with. We probably should go ahead and hook this fan up as well. This computer is not a low power computer. What I usually build in these cases is a system that has a CPU under 20 watts. But in this instance, well, their available motherboard stock has been pretty bad for such systems. Plus, it's harder to get the chips that go in it. Okay, there is a header here that says CHA fan. That means chassis fan or case fan. So I'm going to take this fan, and the wire is incredibly lengthy, so I'm actually going to do the same trick that I did with the CPU fan, but I'm probably going to double the number of knots that I use. The main thing that I'm concerned with is I don't want these wires to get into any of the fans, because that will stop everything dead in their tracks. This power wire is curling in an unfavorable way. If you bend it, there's a zip tie cube there. If you bend it the right way, you can get it to stay put, and it'll just hang on that zip tie end between the heatsink and fan. That does reduce airflow a little bit, but you should be running a burn-in test on any computer that you do so that you know that it's not going to mess up on the customer later. I'm going to feed the power wires back into the clip that's supposed to retain them here and get this data cable out of the way, get these electrical wires out of the way. We need to get this drive cage installed again. So get everything out of the way and watch out, it'll hang up here. You need to get all these screw holes magically mounted back up. Little screws that hold it in. These you can just tighten immediately because there are guides that make the cage sit the way it's supposed to. There we go. I'm going to shove this down here, get it out of the way. This is one of the hard parts. You can get the one that goes in this hole. The one that goes in this hole is fairly easy to get to. But the one that goes in the other hole, underneath all these wires, is not easy. You will want a magnetic screwdriver if you're going to do this. If you don't have a screwdriver that has been magnetized, you really need one. Any nice, strong, permanent magnet can be stroked against a screwdriver to magnetize it. I've covered that in another video, but it doesn't hurt to cover it again. Go ahead and hook your solid-state drive data cable up to the first serial ATA port. This says SATA 3-1, SATA 3-2. We have SATA 3-1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, according to these little silkscreen texts on the board. So our hard drive, which is our solid state drive in this case, we'll go to the first one, which is 3_1. And now we have this horrible wire. What are we going to do with this horrible long wire that we really don't want to be there? Well, first of all, I made a mistake. I want this power to be here, not over here. And we need to tuck this power connector. It needs to be stuffed underneath the solid state drive out of the way. We're not going to use the other connector either, but it may not fit. So we're going to hide all that. This cable, you can bring it up, loop it around like this, and it will hold, in this particular case, it will hold a shape sort of like that, if you can see it. Yep. Now, we still have a lot of wires that need to be dealt with. You got your high definition audio and USB, and they're just hanging all over the place. So, what are we going to do? Well, the high definition audio, you can put it down here. It will be held in place by tension. But even if it comes up, it's not likely to come into the fan, so don't worry too much about that one. This USB one is a little bit more frustrating. What I do is I run it down here. But wait, there's something else that has to be done. We have these wireless antenna things. They need to be dealt with. So what do? Open! Be careful when you pour them out. These need to be installed. This part is not fun. Put one of them through a hole in the back of the computer and hold it with one hand. Try to hold the case too. Then put one of these washers, which will help to retain it. Take these thin nuts and get them to where they will go on. You will need to get a set of pliers. Actually, two sets of pliers to tighten these. For the immediate moment, it will be sufficient just to get them where they belong, and you can tighten a little bit later. Don't worry about getting them too tight. They'll only go so far. They'll just come loose again anyway. You'll still need to go back with pliers and tighten them at the very end. Now, this part is not fun. Underneath where these USB wires go, do you see these incredibly tiny little wireless antenna ports? I hate this part. But take your antennas, hook the first one, the closest one to you. You need to run the wire in sort of a loop. That was rough. Man, that was rough. Okay, I have to redo some of the work that I did because that was, quite frankly, one of the most horrible things ever, and I never want to do it again. Next time I'll just give them a USB wireless adapter if they need one. Right? We can't apply these antennas yet. We can take them out of the bag. Oh, God almighty. Tough stuff. Alright, I need a break. You need pliers. You will need pliers for these pesky things. Now, which plier goes where? That's kind of up to you. I'm gonna put the big one on the inside, if I can. Tighten these up. If you don't tighten them enough, they'll pop loose as soon as you put the antenna on. Woo! Come on now. Well, that's pretty tight. Yep, that's tight enough. If rotating the antenna does not twist it off, then you're good. A little harder to do it from this angle. Huh. Might have to switch hands. Good. The IO shield is flexible, so don't worry about the little bit of flex that they'll have. Let's set these aside. Oh, before I forget. Put the rubber feet in the box. For the most part, this computer is assembled. However, we need the optical drive. Remember how I said this went into it last? Let's open it. Let's see what we've got in here. It's an optical drive. I'm shocked. Ah, Nero Essentials. I never use that. The customer might. I doubt it because I know who the customer is. But I'll put it in the box anyway. If nothing else, at least they're getting a complete set of everything that came with their computer. All right, get this out of your way. Now, how does this go in? Well, it's complicated. Use these clips to get the faceplate off. It's not easy to get the faceplate off. And the deal is that the drive goes in like this, but you can't just shove it in. The faceplate has to be installed. But you just took it off. Well, yes, and there's a reason for this. If I peel this vinyl back, and the click lock door is opened, there is a blank in there that needs to be removed. Now we have a nice clean hole. I always give the customer their blank. So put this back on, which is an exercise in frustration until you get the hang of it. And even then, sometimes not. I like to peel this vinyl up so it doesn't get caught in between the lip of the face and the metal frame. Put this in the bottom holes and wiggle it until it goes on the top. Things don't always sit quite right, so. Sorry about that. So check. There's still a gap right here. Easily fixed. One more shot. Now the drive goes in. We're going to need the power for it, which I'll go ahead and hook up here. Remember how we use the angle cable for the SATA drive that's down here? Well, that's because you might think you could use it for this one, but there's not much room behind it, and it'll cause you all kinds of problems once you've pushed it all the way in. So while you still have this drive loose, you're going to want to hook it into any of the SATA connectors that are not the first one. It doesn't matter which. Now, I would normally be inclined to hook it up here, but if I take it and hook it up over here instead, then it won't get in the way as much when I push the drive itself back in. Also, I'd like for this wire to get hidden under the drive when it goes in. So I'm going to go ahead and push it and have it hang around this corner. And then I'm going to push the drive in, get your fine threaded screws here. And once you've got one in, it's not going anywhere. Do a double check and make sure that all of your wires are out of the way, that they're not going to get in the way of the fan should they be moved around. This one I'm not too worried about. The optical drive pushed some of these wires up against one another, but those wires aren't coming down. So the amount of tension on each of these wires is going to prevent it from getting in the fans. And that's really all that I care about. So, we're done with assembly. The only thing at this point is to reinstall the case lid. That's really all there is to it. Now we just apply licenses, stickers, whatever, and you've got yourself a computer. Final note, I usually allow the customer to decide where these little rubber feet are going to go. I don't make that decision for them because I have no idea if they're going to want to stand it up like this or if they're going to want to set it down more like this. Don't make the assumption. Let them figure it out, tell them about it when you give them the machine, and you don't have to worry about it. At that point, it's their problem, not yours, and you don't have to worry about having made the wrong decision for them. I hope you've enjoyed this. It's been a little bit excruciating considering those wireless connectors are always such a wonderful thing to do, but I enjoyed doing it with you. Have a wonderful day. So I just built this computer, right? And it's got a cool solid-state drive in it. But what's so great about a solid-state drive, you might wonder? Well, let me show you. Count! How many seconds from when I press that button is this bad boy going to be at the desktop and ready to go? I'll give you a hint. The last time I used a stopwatch, it was 14. Oh, that might be faster. So that's why you should buy a computer from me, I guess. Have a good one.